Let's go ahead and get started. So, because I'll probably need it, let's pray again. Not that one, this one. There we go. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O ineffable Creator, who from the treasures of your wisdom have established three hierarchies of angels, have arrayed them in marvelous order above the fiery heavens, and have marshaled the regions of the universe with such artful skill, you are proclaimed the true font of light and wisdom, and the primal origin raised high beyond all things. Pour forth a ray of your brightness into the darkened places of my mind. Disperse from my soul the twofold darkness into which I was born, sin and ignorance. You make eloquent the tongues of infants, refine my speech, and pour forth upon my lips the goodness of your blessing. Grant to me keenness of mind, capacity to remember, skill in learning, subtlety to interpret, and eloquence in speech. May you guide the beginning of my work, direct its progress, and bring it to completion. You who are true God and true man, who live and reign, world without end. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So this second talk is in some ways a very different talk. So the last talk was focused on a particular question and the relationship between philosophy of nature and contemporary science, how to think about this. This talk is much, 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 much more indirectly a philosophy of nature talk, and more trying to step back and take a bit more 1,000-foot view or it's like 56 billion light year view of the universe and say, okay, how do we try to, what are the first steps we might make? And looking at contemporary questions coming from modern science and seeming contradictions with questions of the faith. And the focus is going to be, in a certain sense, what St. Thomas, you know, prays about in his prayer of O Ineffable Creator, about God who is the wise orderer of all things. Can we make sense of God as the wise orderer of all things in the context of how, in the context of modern science, and specifically in the context of the Big Bang? All right, let me make sure I'm organized. I'm trying to work with two computers here, so I'm probably going to mess it up. There we go. Okay. So, I don't know about you, but when I think about creation, as a Catholic who's kind of interested in science, there's this weird amalgam of images that pop into my mind. In some ways, it's sort of like some combination of a Discovery Channel or Nova or some popular science YouTube channel video of a massive explosion, and then I like to think there's this really deep voice. Think like James Earl Jones or Morgan Freeman in the beginning. This is weird mix of sort of scientific and religious imagery. And in one sense, that's not a bad place to start, but it puts us into a sense of seemingly, at least for some, unbearable tension. Because if you read past in the beginning, what we find is the 7 days of creation. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, the earth was without form and shape. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw the light was good, then separated the light from the darkness. And we continue on with the 7 days of creation, separation of dark from light, of earth from waters, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a way in which when we read that religious imagery, right, there is a concreteness to it. There is God's activity is obvious. God did this, then he did that, saw it was good. The next day he did this other thing. He saw that was good. Later on, Adam and Eve show up and God's talking to Adam and Eve. There's this direct activity of God in the, and an obvious role of God in this religious picture of nature. And it seems nice and neat and beautiful, and it is. But when we look to the scientific picture of the beginning, right, we get a picture of the Big Bang. And what is that picture? Well, this is a kind of, schematic drawing that NASA gave to try to express some aspect of what's going on in the Big Bang. And the first thing we notice is that there's 13.7 billion years. So there's a very, very, very long time from the Big Bang to where we are. And what is the Big Bang? Well, this Big Bang is, this rapid expansion. So, rapid is like, it's the most... It's so inadequate to what's actually going on. So so matter in space expands 10 to the 26 times, right? So the density that it started, think 10 to the 26. So that's a one with 26 zeros after. That's an inconceivably large number. And it does that in the space of 10 to the negative 36 seconds. So that's think, okay, 10 with 36 zeros on under after that, one divided by that. So like another inconceivable number. So you're taking an inconceivably large number, dividing it by times one over this inconceivable. It's the rate of this expansion is literally unimaginable. It's so far outside of anything we could ever get our head around experience. And it's the very definition of violent and chaotic explosion. Okay, so that's very different from this seemingly careful ordering of things by God. But it gets, in some ways, it gets worse. More explosions, more chaos. So the initial Big Bang, things sort of, the matter is spread out over the course of billions of years. It slowly recollects into what the proto-galaxies and proto-stars. Those things ignite, become nuclear furnaces that then are the initial generation of stars. In a relatively quick couple billion years, those then explode and spray matter all over the place, and then continue to recollect to make more stars and explode again. And eventually there's complicated enough stuff, roughly about 4.5 billion years ago, in one of those collections, on the periphery of this nuclear furnace that became our sun, some of that matter collected into what is now the Earth. About 4.5 billion years ago, there is the development of life about 4 billion years ago, the rise and fall of species after species, roughly 100,000 years ago, the beginning of the presence of Homo sapiens, but there's just this whole story puts so much distance between us and creation, between human persons and creation. There's roughly 13.7 billion years between us and the beginning. And so how is it that we can try to reconcile this seemingly personal and direct activity of God that seems to come out of Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2 with this seemingly distant, chaotic, expansive picture that comes from modern science? On the surface of it, these seem to be irreconcilable. Now, again, this is just a part of the picture. I mean, in theory, there are theories that there might have been something before the Big Bang, that this might just be a fraction of what's going on in all of reality, that we're just some small branch in a larger structure of the universe. I'll mention that again briefly later. But for now, I want to turn in sort of embracing that tension, I want to look more closely at the scriptures and try to get our head around how exactly we should try to read and understand Genesis chapter 1 in particular. So when we think about creation in the scriptures, right? Most people's default is to think about Genesis chapter 1. In fact, actually, I think most people probably default to some weird amalgam of Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. Because already, right away, there are two accounts of creation. They are, you know, related to one another in some sense, but you have the entire creation up through human persons, and it was very good, and then it's, oh wait, we're creating human persons again. Okay, this is interesting. So already just there's a tension. But if we actually think about creation in the scriptures as a whole, there's a whole lot of other creation narratives or discussions of creation that go beyond, they may not be as detailed in particular as Genesis chapter 1 and 2, but they parallel them in various ways. So for instance, Genesis chapter 1, again, the beginning of Genesis chapter 2, right? We've just finished the all of creation and it says, now this is the story of the heavens and the earth at their creation. There's already this initial tension, even intentionally put there by the authors of Genesis. I mean, if they wanted to, they could have just erased that line perhaps and said, okay, let's just, you know, try to see if we can force these to be one story. No, they just decided to put these two stories right next to each other. But we can go into things like Proverbs. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limits so that the waters might not transgress his command, When he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him like a master workman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always. Again, this is neither Genesis chapter 1 nor Genesis chapter 2. There are echoes that you could see in one or the other or both of them. And yet there is a density to the conversation about creation in the scriptures that goes beyond simply just the text of Genesis chapter 1 or the text of Genesis chapter 2. So that's just a first thing to remember and not lose sight of. But even if we did try to focus on just Genesis chapter 1, which I'm going to do for the rest of the talk, even there's this impression that we might have, particularly from today's day and age, that our reading of Genesis chapter 1 was honestly just really easy up until roughly 150 years ago, where it was just pretty obvious what Genesis chapter 1 was trying to say. And then modern science comes along, evolution and the Big Bang, and now we got to start getting creative. Now we have to start thinking like, okay, well, let's see how much we can tweak this and play with this. And this is some weird modern invention of modern scripture scholarship, the idea of trying to think allegorically about what's going on in Genesis chapter 1. And there's, I think, a common understanding that filters in among many Christians that the conversation about Genesis chapter 1 only really got complicated relatively recently. And that's simply false. That's just not true. If you look at the church fathers talking about Genesis chapter 1, there is a huge range of opinions about how they read Genesis chapter 1. Some of them do read it as a very simplistic 7 24-hour days. A day is a day. I know what a day is. A day is a 24-hour period. Others sort of expand on that. For God, a day is like 1,000 years. So it's 7 eras, maybe of explicitly 1,000 years, or maybe of an indeterminable length. That there is, that this is talking about the order in which things happen, but day is a metaphorical kind of conversation. Some think of it not even as days. These aren't really meant to be these aren't intended by the very authors of scripture to express 24-hour periods, but to express a certain ordering and priority. A particular note, just for the sake of time, I'm gonna jump to Augustine, who is already in some ways reacting against previous church fathers. But Augustine wrote on Genesis a lot. He's very concerned about Genesis, in part because of what was preached about or came up in the tour yesterday, that he was a Manichaean. You believe the writings of Manichae which is a certain like ancient precursor to the Albigensian heresy that St. Dominic was preaching against. And he believed in this idea that there was a good God and an evil God. And the evil God created material stuff. The good God created spiritual stuff. And so we had to fight off the material stuff and fight off our material nature to get to the evil material nature and get to the good spiritual nature. So when he converted to Catholicism, it was very important for him to understand how exactly it is that God created, the one God created, and what he created was good. So he, at various points, he has various commentaries on Genesis. It comes up in the Confessions. It comes up all over the place. Some of them are unfinished, but there's one interesting one where he has it's Genesis ad literum, his literal commentary on Genesis. And so I was like, oh, okay, so this is going to be his basic, simple, straightforward reading. So it should be pretty obvious what he's going to say. Light is light, day is day. So let's look at Genesis. How does in book 1, chapter 9 of Genesis ad literam, what does Augustine say about let there be light? But if the light, spoken of all in words, let there be light, and light was made, must be supposed to have a primacy in creation, it is nothing other than intellectual life. That's weird. That doesn't sound like light. This reflection he has on Genesis, the literal interpretation of Genesis, it is beautiful and interesting in his own right. In certain ways, he kind of steps away from it later in his career. But what he's trying to emphasize here is he wants to say that he has this intuition that creation could not have happened over time. It had to have happened instantaneously. And where is he getting that from? He's getting that from philosophical reflection on nature. That in a certain sense, like the best science of his day, as he understood it, the very idea that there would be stages in creation didn't make sense to him. And so he thought that that was a flawed way of understanding reality. So that couldn't be what the scriptures were really literally trying to say. That couldn't be what the authors of scripture were trying to say. So he was trying to express a reading of Genesis that was literal, that was what the person who wrote this had in their mind when they were expressing this. And he incorporated into that his best understanding of the philosophical and theological truths about creation that he had. So for him, this conversation about Genesis chapter 1 is actually, in a certain sense, God revealing to the angels the ordering of the physical order. And so let there be light is the first sort of the intellectual life of the angels that is expressed to them. Then there's sort of particular meanings to morning and evening, particular meanings to these various other aspects. The point I want to get across here is simply that in the Christian tradition, literal reading of scripture did not mean, okay, day, let me go look up the dictionary. What does day mean? Okay, that's what this means. What is light? Let me go look in the dictionary what light is. That's what light means. Literal was, what was the intention of the author? We as human persons know that we can write in metaphor and poetry. I can exaggerate at times. And yet I can be telling truths in the midst of that exaggeration. I can be telling truths in the midst of that metaphor. So the idea that there was a literal reading of scripture that was not literalistic, that was not the simplest reading, the first reading that came to mind, was already present in the church fathers. Not all the church fathers agreed with them. Some of them read it, again, more explicitly literal, more, you know, 724 hour periods, but there was a range of opinions here. But importantly, Augustine in another work on Genesis, just titled On Genesis, also lays out, a later work, lays out important principles for how to think about and talk about Genesis. And they're really important principles for how to think about and talk about scripture as a whole. So I'm gonna look at three passages from three chapters in this work on Genesis that Augustine is laying out important principles of how to think about, particularly times when the scriptures are talking about the physical world and natural reality, things that we can come to understand by natural means. So he says, in matters that are obscure and far beyond our vision, and like the very beginning of the universe is probably about as obscure and far beyond our vision on a natural level as we can get, even in such as we may find treated in holy scriptures, different interpretations are sometimes possible without prejudice to the faith that we have received. In such a case, we should not rush in headlong and so firmly take our stand on one side that if further progress in the search of truth justly undermines this position, we too fall with it. That would be to battle not for the teaching of Holy Scriptures, but for our own, wishing its teaching to conform to ours, whereas we ought to wish ours to conform to that of sacred scripture. So even though he is, for instance, presenting this particular reading of the literal reading of scriptures, he is careful to say this is not the only possible way to read this. He respects the other church fathers enough to say that there is a range of opinion here. It's possible to sort of see this slightly differently without giving up what is core to the faith. But he goes on in the next chapter to say, it is a disgraceful and dangerous thing for an infidel, apologies for the slightly archaic way of talking about those, the non-believers, to hear a Christian, presumably giving the meaning of Holy Scripture, talking nonsense on these topics, topics related to the earth, heaven, stars, plants, animals. If they find a Christian mistaken in a field which they, the non-believer, themselves know very well, and hear him maintaining his foolish opinions about our books, about the scriptures, how are they, this non-Christian, going to believe those books in matters concerning the resurrection of dead, the hope of eternal life, and the kingdom of heaven? If we so insist on our particular interpretation of the you know, aspects related to how the heavens work coming out of the scriptures, that we so insist upon this when someone who has actually studied the heavens, studied astronomy, says that's just false and knowably false, then we are actually providing a barrier to them understanding what is actually important. In a certain sense, yes, it's interesting what the scriptures might say about the heavens, but that's not the source of our salvation. The source of our salvation is Jesus Christ and him crucified. And so if we put up barriers to people receiving the core aspect of our salvation, we're doing it wrong. Now, similarly, he goes in the other direction. More dangerous is the error of certain weak brethren, so Christians, who faint away when they hear there's these irreligious critics, or the non-believers, who are disparaging the scriptures as unlearned. So they're you know, so a non-Christian talking about the scriptures and saying it's silly and doesn't make any sense. And yet they are learnedly, these non-Christians, learnedly and eloquently discoursing on theories of astronomy, with a sign that they esteem these teachers as superior to themselves, and they return to disdain to the books which were written for the good of their souls. So there's a way in which bad interpretations of scriptures are an impediment to non-believers coming to understand the core truths of the faith. And they're also a danger to believers, that if we misunderstand how to read the scriptures and become so fascinated with the amazing truths that come from outside the scriptures that we disparage the scriptures themselves and find them unhelpful, then we are a danger to our own salvation as well. So it's important to have that right balance between what the scriptures are able to convey, what the scriptures are trying to convey, and how they interact and can interact well with our best understanding of the natural world. So I want to just take a moment then, and just very, very briefly, so we're going to, in line with that sort of tension that between that sort of trying to hold together the scientific and the religious, I'm going to shift very quickly from the religious back to the scientific. Say, okay, so where exactly does this notion of 13.8 billion years come from? And I'm going to do it in a very sketchy way, but just to motivate this for people who haven't actually kind of delved into this themselves, just with a couple of examples. There are various ways in which you can figure out how old stuff is. One of the most powerful in terms of stuff we can get our hand on is called radiometric dating. Roughly speaking, stuff that is radioactive decays at a certain rate. We don't know exactly when any particular radioactive atom is going to decay, but on average, they decay at a certain rate. And so if we have a certain sense of how much radioactive stuff should have been present at when something was first formed usually in the center of some star, then we can get a general sense of how old it is by how much the radioactive stuff has decayed. So this is a picture of the Canyon Diablo meteorite. So this is just a hunk of rock that fell out of the sky and we found in Canyon Diablo, and just a basic lead dating. So this is a certain kind of radioactive lead isotope decaying into non-radioactive lead. By using that dating, we can date this to roughly 4.5 billion years. So we're already on the scale of billions, right? We throw that word around a lot. I think the closest, ancient cultures, there are certain ancient thinkers that thought the universe always existed and was infinite. There are certain ancient cultures that thought the universe wasn't infinite, it was finite. The numbers you hear for how old the universe is maybe get up to like the millions range, like thousands upon thousands. The idea of billions is like beyond the scope of most ancient cultures. Just no one even conceived of the fact that the universe would be that old. There are arguments that maybe the Mayans did. If you multiply together all their calendars, it gets to like roughly a billion or so. But just on human scales, billion is huge. So I just want to like emphasize that. So we have stuff that we can touch and mess with that we have very, very strong reasons to think is billions of years old. We can do similar kinds of radiometric dating with stars we can figure out the elements present in stars based off of the spectrum, like related to what I was saying about how different elements tend to interact with particular wavelengths of light. That gives us insight into what elements might be in the stars. We can do similar kind of dating on stars, radiometric dating, which puts the age of those stars in the range of tens of billions. So there's big error bars on it, but it's like, 15 plus or minus 4 billion years. So, but we're now into like the 10 to 15 billion years range. We can also lean on the fact that we have a really good understanding of how stars age. That when stars, when they're created, depending on the particular material constitution of those stars. And here, I'm just gonna have to like apologize to Juliana sitting over here, who's an actual astrophysicist, that I'm just gonna butcher this horribly very quickly. That broadly speaking, right, when a galaxy is formed and you get tons and tons of stars that are born, they roughly fall along this diagonal line, right? That initially when stars are born, they fall somewhere along with this line, which is the main sequence. And the stars up in the top left, which are blue, are the hottest stars and burning the brightest and tend to burn out quickest. Whereas the stars down at the bottom are more red light, they're less hot, and they just tend to last longer. And so we can actually look at a galaxy and say, okay, a brand new galaxy should have stars along this entire line. And as the stars age, slowly these stars from the top left are gonna start drifting over into the supergiant region. And so based off of how, you know, the distribution of stars we can see, and we can get a sense of this from the light coming from the stars and other ways of measuring exactly where they fall on this plot, the older a galaxy is, the older a galaxy is, sort of the further, you know, the more of the top left that is going to get curved over into the top right. So if we look at two examples of this, right on the left here is a galaxy M67. And so as you can see here, there's this like really strong, dense line that follows roughly that main sequence. But it doesn't, you know, at some point, the stuff in the very, very top left has aged out and started to drift over to the right. So this galaxy, based off our understanding of how, you know, by lots and lots of galaxies, how they age, we can say that this galaxy is roughly 3 to 5 billion years old. Whereas here we have M4, which what I understand is one of, if not the oldest galaxy we've kind of come across. And here it's a bit of a mess, right? Like you've got a little bit of the main sequence down here in the bottom right, but most of the galaxies have drifted off to the right. And so we can get a sense that this must be a much, much older galaxy. And we can age this one to roughly 12 to 13 billion years. So now we have physical radioactive dating that's giving us ranges of, you know, tens of billions of years. We have this, the development of stars, which is giving us ranges of 10 to 12 billion years. We can also make predictions for the age of the universe based off of the overall expansion of the universe, right? So what do I mean by that? So the center of this plot, 0 years, is today. And we can look out and we can see that most of the universe is moving away from us. There's an expansion of the universe, right? And so if we just run that tape backwards, that means the universe is gonna get smaller and smaller and smaller. And eventually that gets us back to the Big Bang, which we presume to be sort of, you know, the beginning of the universe, that age that we're looking for. Now, depending on the particular properties of the universe, the way in which the way in which you need to run that backwards is going to change. So these are just different sort of types of universes, basically different distributions of types of matter in the universe. And depending on which particular value of these constants you get, it might be that from where we are today, it gets back to the Big Bang quicker. So more like 5 billion years, 10 billion years, 15 billion years. So if we understand these overall properties of the universe, we can trace back to exactly when the universe is. Now, there's like the data we've been able to collect makes it much more simple than just this nice little two-dimensional plot. But with some of the most sensitive detection we've been able to do of what is called the cosmic microwave background, this is sort of the first light that we can see that has escaped the early universe. And I'm not gonna go into the details of this, but this is in a certain sense, a picture not of the Big Bang per se, but not that long after the Big Bang. And it's the light that's coming from us. And the variation in color here is very, very sensitive. But by figuring out the distribution of that variation, it helps us to understand that the overall structure of the universe from that early date through to today. And from that is where we can get our most accurate measurement for how old the universe is, when the Big Bang happened. And as far as I understand, the best number we can put on that is 13.799 plus or minus 0.21 billion years. So we're very, very confident that we are in this 13.7, 13.8 billion year range. So even with that general picture we're painting of, okay, the universe is this 13.8 billion years, we have all this data pushing us in this huge scale that involves sort of this violent expansion and contraction, all of these different processes. How exactly, even if we're try to be as flexible as we can with Genesis chapter one, how exactly do these things come together? What are the principles by which we say this is okay and that's not okay in our reading of Genesis chapter one? So for here, I want to, in a certain sense, shift back into the theological side and shift into how Aquinas talks about this very, very problem. Again, he's not addressing our problem. He's not addressing the Big Bang. But what he is addressing is the problem that you start to see in Augustine and is now even more present in his own day of just the range of opinions that the church fathers have on how to read Genesis chapter one. That in and of itself is a problem independent of exactly what you think your cosmology is. And so he's trying to, following the lead of Augustine, lay out what are the core ideas and principles that unify what the church fathers have to say. Particularly in the Summa, earlier on, he was a little more precocious in this, but generally speaking, Aquinas is very loath to say this church father is right and that church father is wrong. He does his best to try to incorporate and read charitably all of them. And there is nowhere where this is more present than in his discussion of the hexameron, of the Genesis chapter one. In fact, rather than being this sort of easy thing to read until 150 years ago, in a very real sense that you see initially in the church fathers and even more so in Aquinas, Genesis chapter one is where the church learned to read the scriptures in a very complex and sophisticated way. Some of the most sort of complicated and detailed discussion Aquinas has on the interpretation of scripture and the reading of scripture comes out of his treatment of the hexameron and questions around the fact that so many church fathers said diametrically opposed things about what was going on here. So where's the unity? Where is the unity of inspiration in the fact that the church fathers end up in different places? So in addressing this, Aquinas says, okay, well, those things that pertain to the faith are distinguished in two ways. For there are things that are of themselves of the substance of the faith, such as that God is three and one. And this kind of thing in which no one is permitted to opine otherwise. But other things are only accidentally of the substance of the faith, insofar, namely, as they are handed on in the scripture. So anything in the scripture is at least related to the faith, and we need to deal with it seriously. But there are aspects of the scripture that are so immediately to the core of the faith, and other aspects that are more accidentally related. And such are many historical facts, which can, without danger, be unknown by those who are not obligated to know. When you get to heaven and St. Peter welcomes you to heaven, he's not going to quiz you on the details of the order of the kings of the Israelite kingdom. When exactly did the temple fall? Who exactly took it over? There's not a test about the history. Those things are important to the faith. They solidify and strengthen the faith, but they're not exactly the core of the faith. They're not the reason that we are saved. And on these kinds of facts, even the fathers held diverse opinions, explaining sacred scripture diversely. Thus, concerning the beginning of the world, there is something that pertains to the substance of the faith, namely, that the created world had a beginning. And all the fathers agree on this. But how it began and in what order it was made pertained to the faith only accidentally. Insofar as these opinions are handed on in scripture, whose truth the fathers, holding diverse opinions, handed on by diverse explanations. So here is at least one example of something he's saying, where when we think of the stories of creation, there is a unity among the fathers of the fact that there was a beginning to the creation of the universe, even if they debate about exactly how and in what order that beginning came about. So this is a hint and a tool or how we might look at Genesis chapter one, that there are certain aspects coming out of the reading of the Genesis chapter one that are that are common to the fathers, and that's a first good hint. And I would argue can be made can be reconciled with a contemporary understanding of modern science. So I'm going to propose four such truths. This is, in certain sense, just, I mean, it's a list I've come up with. You can find echoes of this in Aquinas. I don't think he lists these four in particular anywhere, but you can find echoes of it in him and in the church fathers. And I think they are kind of standard Catholic readings, even up until you look at contemporary conversations about Genesis chapter one. These are four theological truths that are very clearly being expressed in Genesis chapter one. They are, first, as Aquinas says, that there was a beginning in the beginning. Right, check. Two, that there is order in the created world. The world was without form and shape, then God said, and something happened. So that there is something of order that is being put into the created world by creation, that it's not random and chaotic, that God is putting order there. That there is goodness in the created world. God saw that it was good. And finally, that humanity is in some sense a pinnacle of creation. Let us make human beings in our image after our likeness. There's something different about human persons that is not true about the rest of creation. And all the church fathers, whatever they might read about light and days and the order in which things happened, would agree on these four principles. The thing is, on first blush, even these four principles seem kind of problematic. How exactly are these four things really actually true in the context of modern Big Bang cosmology, right? I mean, perhaps the first one is easiest in the sense that, right, at least compared to the way people thought about the universe before the early 20th century, this is much, much more conducive to the idea of there being a beginning. There is, in fact, an image of what the beginning might have looked like or did look like. Now, again, if we look at this, I mean, this plot starts somewhere, right? So the fact that there is a beginning to this plot is at least an echo of the fact that science points us toward at least the possibility of there being a beginning. Now, again, there are other models by which the Big Bang is just a part of a larger structure. So either this sort of, expanding and collapsing repeated process, or that like our universe is one larger structure of some larger things. There are various reasons to think that these are not scientifically unreasonable arguments. There are certain philosophical issues I have with them, both as a physicist and as a philosopher, but they're not, it may be that the Big Bang was not the beginning, but there are fairly compelling arguments to be had that there probably was a beginning. I'm still going to hold for Aquinas being right on the fact that we can't know that for certain, but that's a conversation for later. Okay, so that one's fairly easy, but what about there is order in the created world, right? I mean, like all those massive chaotic explosions, right? This little image here, right? This earliest sign of light is literally, I mean, it's a little snapshot of the quantum randomness of what was going on in the early universe. And there's like these minor fluctuations that seem to be just randomly distributed. Where is there order in this? Where's the pattern in this quantum randomness? Well, I think sometimes we overemphasize the dichotomy between randomness and order. So imagine, for instance, your junk drawer. So this is a cardboard box with a bunch of stuff I pulled out. I don't really have a drawer, it's more a shelf. So if I took a bunch of stuff and throw it in a box and I shake the box up, random, chaotic, as it's shaking, it's moving all over the place. As I slow down, watch, you end up with a random chaotic mess. So in a certain sense here, it starts random, it stays random, it's just a hunk, a mess of randomness. But, there we go. Now, same box, but I put a bunch of ping pong balls in it, right? So as I start shaking, right, chaos, randomness, things bouncing around. Try to keep track of any one ball. It's going to be horribly hard. It's just going all over the place, As we settle down, a little bit of a tilt just to make sure everything kind of leans in one direction, a certain kind of pattern emerges. If you look here, let me get the mouse over here, right? You can see this sort of hexagonal pattern where you have, a ball in the middle and six balls around it here, a ball in the middle and six balls around it there, a ball in the middle and six balls around it here. You end up getting, yes, it was random, and it is in a certain sense random, right? If I told you to keep track of any one ball, you'd have a hard time figuring out where it ended up in this structure. So there's still randomness here of which ball ended up where, and yet there is order that seems to have emerged out of that randomness. Where did that order come from? And importantly, right, so this kind of order shows up, this kind of order, this particular order, this hexagonal packing pattern shows up all over the place. It's just a grocery store. It's the most efficient way to pack spheres. So as you try to stack spheres, you get this pyramidal structure, and you can see these sort of hexagonal patterns, this six-fold symmetry. If you look at bees in a beehive, right, you get the same sort of six-fold pattern, the circular body of the bees trying to get as efficiently as possible. You get the hexagon again. There we go. You sneezeweed, everyone's favorite plant. These balls pack as tightly as they can. You get, again, this sort of hexagonal packing pattern. The eye of a fly, again, these, you know, circular things crammed together, you get this hexagonal packing pattern. There's a way in which this order, this particular pattern, seems to show up everywhere in nature. Where is it coming from? In a certain sense, it seems to come out of nothing, and yet, I would argue that it actually comes from the fact that all of the things we're packing together here are circles. Think about a circle, think about a sphere. You could take that sphere and rotate it in any pattern you would want, rotate it in any direction you would want, and it's spherically symmetric. In mathematics, you say it has it's infinite symmetry. You can rotate it by any angle and you'll get the sphere back. But the hexagon, right, it's a six-fold symmetry. There's only certain angles you can rotate this structure to kind of reproduce itself. So there's a weird way in which actually what we had was a bunch of individual things with more symmetry. And when we crammed them together under certain circumstances, they lost symmetry in a certain sense. There's sort of less order and yet new order. There's a different kind of order that emerges because there is a deeper order in the sphere that then manifests itself in this very visual, more present order. So this is, you know, this is in some sense just a big geometry problem, trying to sort of fit certain shapes together. But for various reasons, for physicists, this kind of symmetry goes even deeper and goes beyond three-dimensional space and into the way that particles relate to one another. Again, because I have to talk about particle physics, I apologize. So there's a moment in the history of the development of particle physics where we had observed all sorts of hadrons, mesons and baryons. These are basically different ways in which quarks can collect together in relatively stable patterns. And when when physicists looked at all of them, they realized they could organize them into these plots based off of the quantum numbers, the various properties that these collected particles had. And so you have here, the mesons make this really nice hexagon with two at the middle and six around the edge. Here you have the baryons with two in the middle and six around the edge, or a certain kind of baryon. Another group of baryons though, you get a trapezoid. I mean, trapezoids are okay, but it's a trapezoid. Wouldn't it be so much cooler if there were a particle right there that just made it into a triangle? I mean, isn't a triangle so much better than a trapezoid? Maybe you don't get that, but it's for the physicists, there seems to be a symmetry that's demanding there be one more particle there. And for various reasons, knowing what the quantum numbers were, physicists could predict what the properties of this particle was going to be and what sort of experiment they should run to find it. So they went looking for it and they found it. We found a particle to complete that symmetry. Now, these kinds of symmetries are very, very abstract. They're not visual symmetries, but the particular visual symmetries that make up the particular symmetries that underlie these particles underlie the symmetries in the periodic table, the ordering of the atoms, which underlie the symmetries in molecular structures, which underlie the symmetries, the physical symmetries in larger chemical structures, particularly biological structures. The fact that bees are roughly spherical or roughly circular in their body shape can in some sense be reproduced to a complex collection of how the physical symmetries of a whole complex pattern of chemicals, which can be reduced to a certain symmetries of the atoms, which can be reduced down to the symmetries of those particles. That there's deeper symmetries that when sort of shaken out randomly as if in a box, manifest less symmetry. We talk about, in fact, breaking symmetries in physics. And yet that new broken symmetry allows for more complexity, a different kind of order that wasn't there before. So even though the world is, yes, quantum mechanical and random, that there is order that is actually manifest by that randomness. There are certain kinds of order that just wouldn't be there if we didn't have that randomness as well. And that the more we look at the world, the more we can find those patterns emerging and connect them back to the deeper order at all the different hierarchies stages of being. So we have this notion then that there is a goodness in the created world. Well, you may have heard certain physicists or popular science people talking about, oh, the universe is a cold, dark, empty space that's an uncaring space. And I mean, there's a certain truth to that, right? So if we look at the Milky Way, get my notes back up here real quick. Just want to make sure I'm saying this correctly. There we are. And there's a sense in which people talk about, right? I mean, there is just the very process of what we are depends upon tons and tons of things being created and things dying, death and destruction, things being made and created and destroyed. How is that good? How is all this death and destruction good? It seems like the universe is emptiness, void, with lots of explosions and pain. Where's the goodness in that? So for instance, here we have an example of a supernova, right? It seems like this is the death of a star. What's so good about the death of a star? Well, for the star itself, it's not very good, but if we didn't have a certain number of generations of stars, we didn't have stars, nuclear furnaces, to fuse together the hydrogen and a little bit of helium that was the only element that existed in the early universe, we wouldn't have things like carbon and oxygen and the foundations for most of chemistry. If we didn't have certain kinds of supernova or certain kinds of collapsing neutron stars recently discovered by gravitational wave observatories, like we wouldn't have things like gold and platinum and heavier metals. That so much of what we take for granted about the beauty and complexity of the Earth depends upon generations of stars being born and dying. So while it's not good for that particular star, there is a greater order, there's a greater complexity and beauty to the universe as a whole because of that time, because of that death and destruction. So there's a way in which, just briefly to say that if the universe weren't as old as it is, as big as it is, and didn't have as much birth and dying on a galactic scale, a stellar scale, and even on an evolutionary scale in terms of the birth and death of various species, there wouldn't be the diversity and complexity that we find here on Earth. So that while in one sense, it seems to be not good, a lot of death and destruction, it opens up the possibility of a greater goodness of the whole. So the last one I want to talk about is the idea of humanity being the pinnacle of creation. There's a general sense that people talk about, before Copernicus, everyone thought that the human persons were the center of the universe, and all of modern science has been pushing us farther and farther away from the idea of us being central of the universe. And there's a sense in which that's true, right? So here we have kind of a pictogram of the heavenly spheres, Earth in the middle. But now we know that's not true, right? Our Earth is a part of the solar system. The sun's in the center. We are in there, but we're just like the third rock from the sun. No big deal. And our sun is just like this random spot in the middle of the Milky Way galaxy. And the Milky Way galaxy is just one of this infinite, this massive number of galaxies. So we seem to be just one little speck in this massive structure. What's so important about us? First, a minor correction. The idea that there was a huge importance to the idea of human persons being at the center of the universe is a little bit anachronistic. Because if you look here, the Earth is at the center, but what's really at the center of the universe under the Earth is hell. Being at the center isn't actually that good. That's where there's a way in which actually the best part of the universe was the Imperium Heaven, where Jesus Christ glorified was living, awaiting the return. So this idea of the center being so, 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 so important, the center is where first all the corruptible stuff is, and then even the even worse stuff down below. So the idea of being at the center was not actually such a great thing in that cosmology. But also more broadly, leaning on the things that we were talking about before, well, yes, in a physical sense, we are not the center of the universe. There is a very real sense in which we can see how so much of the universe has been ordered just so that human persons can come to exist. It just is the fact that if we looked at, you know, if you went back to that standard model of particle physics I showed in the last slide, there, I mean, I didn't put up all the different quantities of the different coupling constants, but if you just went in there and decided to muck with the numbers and just throw it back up there, you would not get our universe. You would not get our chemistry. You would not get our biology. In fact, most of those things, it's like maybe a little bit of a percent leeway. And after that, the entire, like something breaks down so early on that you wouldn't even get beyond, you know, lithium and like the second and third element on the periodic table, let alone anything like organic chemistry or biology. That there is something about the overall pattern of the universe that is just so ordered for human persons to come into existence, for biology in the first place, and then human beings. And while people lean into the idea of those anthropic coincidences a different way, is this a sign of God's direct action in the universe or just a particular pattern that we haven't discovered fully? It simply is the case that so much of our universe is just so arranged to allow for the possibility, the length of time and the complexity necessary for the existence of human beings, for the existence of you and me. So while we may not be the physical center of the universe, we are in some very real sense the end of the universe, what the universe is ordered to. That there seems to be something very interesting and unique about the biology that exists on Earth, and in particular, the human species, that as best as we can tell, there's nothing like it in our solar system. There's nothing like it in anything we can see in the universe, despite trying to find it, that there does seem to be something particularly special about humanity. So with that, there's a way in which, although on the surface, these sorts of four truths coming out of Genesis chapter one are often, you know, presumed to be in conflict with contemporary science, understood in the right way, there's a way in which a lot of our cosmos actually fits into this bigger picture of how the universe, of God's creative power, and the truths that are coming out of Genesis chapter one, and even more so when we bring it to bear with a broader understanding of creation and scriptures as a whole. So I will stop there and figure out how much time we have for questions.